So now we start the next property of the atomic nucleus, that is the nuclear density. As we all know that the nuclear density or density is given by the formula of mass upon volume. Density describes how much mass is contained in a particular volume. So density is mass upon volume, and the nucleus is composed of protons and neutrons. So the mass of each nucleon, means the mass of proton as well as mass of neutron, are not differing from much a larger quantity. So the mass of each nucleon is taken to be 1.67 into 10 to the power minus 27 kilogram, and the mass of electron is, we know that it is equal to 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kilogram. So the mass of nucleons or the mass of the nucleus will be m times the mass number A. So we get mass of nucleon is 1.67 10 to the minus 27 into A is the atomic mass number. So that is equal to 1.67 into 10 to the minus 27 A kilograms. Since the volume is a sphere, so it is given by 4 by 3 pi r cube. And r is r naught a raised to power 1 by 3. If we cube the value of r, we get r cube is r naught cube into a. Because cube root into cube is a. So we get the density rho is equal to 1.67 10 to the minus 27 into a upon 4 by 3 pi r naught cube into a, where a and a gets cancelled. So r naught here is taken to be 1.2 Fermi. So we get the density value equal to 2.29 into 10 raised to power 17 kilogram per meter cube. So this value shows that the atomic nucleus is, or the nucleus is having a very high density value of the order of 10 raised to power 17. And since there is no A involved in it, so the density, nuclear density, is independent of the mass number A. It does not depend upon whether we are talking about the density of hydrogen, whether we are talking about the density of carbon, or if we are talking about the density of gold. So the density remains independent of the mass number A, and it is same for all the nuclei. So if we want to calculate the density of the atom, we know that the radius, atomic radius, is 10 raised to power 4 times the nuclear radius. So if we put the value here, 10 raised to power 4, so we calculate that the atomic density comes out to be 2.29 into 10 raised to power 5 kilogram per meter cube. So the atomic density is less than as compared to the nuclear density, where the nuclear density is having a factor of 10 raised to power 7, it is having the factor of 10 raised to power 5. So we can say that the atomic nucleus is much more dense than the atom. So coming to the next, that is the atomic mass unit. We know that what is atomic mass unit, that is 1 AMU is nothing but 1/12th of the mass of neutral carbon 12 atom. We have to take the mass of carbon 12, not carbon 11 or carbon 13 isotope. We have to take the mass of neutral carbon 12. So 1 mole of a substance is the amount which it has mass in grams, and it is equal to the atomic weight. And we know that 1 mole contains number of atoms which is equal to the number given by the Avogadro's number. So N is equal to 6.0225 into 10 raised to power 23. So 1 mole of carbon means 12 gram of atomic carbon atom contains N number of atoms. So if we want to calculate the mass of one single carbon atom, that will be given by 1 by 12 into 12 gram upon N, that is the Avogadro number, which is 6.0225 into 10 raised to power 23. So we get the value of 1 AMU, which is equal to 1.66 into 10 raised to power minus 27 kilogram. So 1 AMU is nothing but 1.66 into 10 raised to power minus 27 of kilogram. So this is the amount of weight that comes in 1 AMU. So if we now want to see in what units we study the energy. So the units of energy are always calculated in electron volts. So what is 1 electron volt? 1 electron volt is the amount of energy that an electron requires to get accelerate to a potential difference of 1 volt. So we can say that 1 electron volt is equal to the charge on electron into 1 volt. Since the charge on the electron is 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19 coulombs and to 1 volt. So we get, this is nothing but 1 electron volt is equal to 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19 joules. If we want to calculate the higher value of the higher order of the electron volt, that is 1 mega electron volt. So 1 mega electron volt is nothing but 10 raised to power 6 electron volts, or it is 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 13 joules. So if we now go to the relation between AMU and energy. Since AMU was nothing but it was the unit of mass. So now we want a relation that would convert the mass into energy and energy into mass. So there is nothing but a relation, very interesting relation given by the Einstein, which was E is equal to mc square. So with this relation we can convert energy into mass and mass into energy. So if we want that, if we take m equal to 1 amu and c equal to 2.99 into 10 raised to power 8 meter per second. So if we put the value of mass and c, we can calculate the energy E. So E comes out to be 1.66 into 10 raised to minus 27, 2.99 into 10 raised to power 8 ka whole square, which is nothing but 1.484 into 10 raised to power minus 10 joules. And also we know that 1 electron volt is nothing but 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19 joules. So we can convert this joules into electron volt by dividing by 1.6 into 10 raised to power minus 19. So we get the energy equal to 931.48 into 10 raised to power 6 electron volt, or we say it is 931.48 mega electron volts. So we say that with this relation we can convert the mass of 1 AMU into energy equivalent, which will be equal to 931.48 mega electron volt. So this relation helps us to identify that 1 AMU is nothing but it is equal to 931.48 mega electron volt, or more precisely to be, we can say it is equal to 931 mega electron volts. So next interesting property of the nucleus is the calculation of nuclear angular momentum. As we know that the nucleus is consisting of protons and neutrons, and it is also revolving in the shells inside the nucleus as the electron is orbiting and it is revolving and rotating about the nucleus. Similarly, the protons and neutrons are also revolving and rotating. So the revolving motion leads to the orbital motion, and the rotational motion leads to the spin motion. So the total angular, if you want to calculate the intrinsic angular momentum or the total angular momentum, which is given by I, or somewhere J is also used to express it. So we say that I is equal to summation L plus minus summation S, where L and S are the orbital and the spin quantum numbers of the nucleons, and the summation L will give contribute to the total angular momentum, and capital S will contribute to the spin angular momentum. And so I will be given by L plus minus of S. So this I, that is the total angular momentum, is also regarded as the nuclear spin. And we know that the protons and neutrons both have half integral spins of half H cross. So if we take the examples, if we have even nuclei where all the nucleons, that is the protons and neutrons, they will all pair up to cancel out their spin and orbital angular momenta. Therefore, the total angular momentum will be equal to zero. Suppose we have, consider the case of 2 He4, 4 beryllium 8, 8 oxygen 16. Here the number of protons are all even, that is 2, 4, 8. And if we calculate the number of neutrons, that is the A minus Z, all will be again equal to 2, 4 and 8. That means that number of protons and the number of neutrons both are even. So all the even protons and neutrons both have their spin and orbital angular momentum cancelled out due to pairing, and therefore the total I is equal to zero nuclear angular momentum. We have zero angular momentum, that is I equal to zero. But if we consider the case of even odd nuclei, for example 4 beryllium 9, here we have 4 protons and here we have 9 neutrons, sorry 5 neutrons. So in 5 neutrons, 4 will pair up and 1 nucleon will be left out, for example. So 1 nucleon will contribute to the unpaired nucleon, will contribute to the momentum, total angular momentum. So we get the, and the proton and neutron are having half integral spins, so the even odd nuclei will give half integral total angular momentum and the total. So now we consider the case of odd odd nuclei. In this odd odd nuclei, suppose we consider the case of 5 boron 10. So here in 5 boron 10 we have 5 protons and 5 neutrons, so there will be unpaired proton and unpaired neutron present. So both the unpaired protons and neutrons will contribute to the total angular momentum. So the total angular momentum would be half h cross for proton and half h cross for neutron. So they will either add or subtract. So it will lead to the integral total angular momentum. Thank you.